We're here to thank God. That's not just a Thanksgiving song. That can be sung any time of the year, right? We give thanks to God every Sunday, every time we have an opportunity to do so. We're just so glad to see you here. So glad to see so many familiar faces and a few visitors too. So that's great to see everybody here. We're glad that you've come to worship with us today. Just a quick reminder, tomorrow night, we're up to episode 7 of season 3 of The Chosen. So we only have one more the following week to finish off season 3. We'll do season 4 probably in the fall. So, but it's been enjoyable. Come on Monday night, 7 o'clock, and it's just been a great time together with God's people. There's popcorn and water there too, so you might want to come for that, all right? Just so glad to see each of you here. I'm not feeling the best today, but I'm here. And because I want to praise the Lord for all that he is. And so let's just spend a few moments in silent prayer, preparing our hearts. Father, we thank you for your presence here today. Thank you that you're a great God and worthy of all praise and thanksgiving. You are the Almighty God, the eternal God, who we worship here today. So encourage our hearts, strengthen us by your Spirit, that as we sing your songs of praises, as we worship you, as we hear from your word and pray, may you encourage our hearts and our lives today. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's stand together. We bring the sacrifice of praise.
Sacrifice.
so true, isn't it? There is none like our wonderful God, our Savior Jesus Christ. Because of all he has done in our behalf, we come to him today. We offer up our prayers on behalf of others. So let's lift up those names that the Lord has placed upon your heart this morning.
Carrie, John and Cheryl House,
the family of Harold Humble,
Benita Hill,
Steve Reeves,
Doug Atwood,
Hale family,
Warren Barkley,
Randy Revin.
By Harris,
Jared Barnes and Welch,
our family and military,
Cheryl Rupert,
Sue and John Wade,
Charlotte Sabians,
our church and pastor,
Betty Hall,
Sheriff of Jerusalem,
Mary Audie.
Henry Farrell,
Monica Beamer,
Donna Sueway,
Todd Jordan,
Bobby Simon,
Mercy Vasquez.
Gracious Heavenly Father, we are grateful to be in your presence today. You're a great God, and there is no one like you. Thank you that Jesus is our Redeemer and our friend. He is our Savior, one that we can go to in our time of need, praying that you will work in ways that are unmistakably you. Father, you've heard these names this morning. So many needs in our church family, and especially those that have lost loved ones this week. We pray for Debbie Meadows and the loss of her nephew, for Lou McConnell, the loss of his sister. Father, we come to you today knowing that you have a plan for us all, that you have answered the prayers of these families because their loved ones are healed, ultimately healed in the presence of our Savior, Jesus Christ. What a great God you are, worthy of all praise and honor and glory and blessing. So, Father, I pray that you would work your plan and your will in each situation. Help us to continue to pray. Help us to be perseverance in our prayers, not just one day a week or occasionally, but every day, because we all need your actions in our lives today. Help us to see that you are the one who has done so much in our behalf. There is no one like our God. We're so grateful for that. Father, we thank you. Thank you for the rain. Thank you for the provisions that you've given us this past week. Help us, Father, to see and hear and know that you are with us, even unto the end of the age. Father, what a great God you are. Because of all that, we pray the prayer that our Savior taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Oh,
What wondrous love our Savior displayed in our behalf.
Amen.
Unbelievable, unimaginable. We cannot even begin to really fully consider all that he has done in our behalf. And the song we've been singing this month expresses those truths of who he is and what he has done in our behalf. If God is for us, who can be against us?
Amen.
Our God is a great God.
Open the
a hard song, Father. To bless you when things are going right, that's easy. But when it's not, it's another thing. Totally different. God says that we are to praise him all the time, no matter what, whether we're going through a desert place or whether we've got sunshine in our lives. And like Job said, I'm going to choose to bless your holy name. The Lord gives and the Lord takes away. Lord, blessed be your name, because you are a great God and worthy of all praise and honor and glory and blessing. So, Father, we praise you today for who you are, for all that you've done on our behalf. We are so grateful to be your children. Thank you, Father, for your presence here today. Instruct us by your Holy Spirit through your word this morning in Jesus' name. Amen. We're in 1 John 4, 7 to 15, if you want to pull out the sermon notes. So I was thinking through this, and I thought of the old Beatles song, All You Need Is Love, you know? And it's true. All we need is God's love. I'd edit that in. Okay, what they were singing about is totally different. But, you know, when we look at God's love for us, it's unique, it's different, and it expresses the truth that God loves us. It's who he is. You know, this is the third time now that John has talked about love in this short epistle. First, he talked about it being a proof of fellowship with God. And in the next chapter, he said it was a proof of us being a child of God. But in this chapter here, he deals with the foundation of love, and that it's a valid test of our fellowship and our union with God. And when we receive Jesus as our Savior, we receive his nature, God's nature within us. And that nature of God is love. That's what John says here. It's love. And therefore, a person who is born again has that nature within them. Each of you, when you receive Christ as Savior, you got the love of God inside. And we are to express that then to others. Now, some people have a hard time expressing love towards each other. We get annoyed and different things. And there's a story about a woman who was bitten by a mad dog and looked as if she was going to die of rabies. So the doctor told her she should make out her will. Taking her pen and paper, she began to write. Continued for quite a while. Finally, the doctor said, "That's surely a long will you're making." The woman retorted, "Will nothing. I'm making a list of all the people I'm going to bite." That's not love. That's not the love of God that we should have for each other, is it? But sometimes we're like that, too. We want to get back. We want vengeance, as mine says the Lord, though, right? It's interesting. A theologian was lecturing at a college, and one of the students asked after the lecture, "In all your years of studying and teaching theology, what's the greatest thought that has ever gone through your mind?" And without hesitation, the man answered, "That Jesus loves me. This I know. For the Bible tells me so." You don't have to be a great theologian to understand that particular truth of Scripture. We know that. It's very important, though, that we think about God correctly. The devil doesn't want us to know and believe that God loves us. Again, he's the author of doubt, just as he was in the Garden of Eden. Did God really say that? He plants doubt. He plants doubt about God's love, about his character, about who he is in our lives. And he's constantly doing that. So we have to know the truth about God's love for us. He tries to distort it. But many times our experiences in life may say that God's not loving and we don't understand him. But the revelation of God in his word clearly states God is love. It's who he is. It's a part of his character. Now, again, when we look at the characteristics and the characters of God, we don't overbalance one without the other. God's holy. He's loving. God's got wrath, anger. He has grace. See, mercy. They all balance out. Have you ever noticed that? There's a balancing act there of God's characteristics. One doesn't outweigh the others. But this is a prominent part of who God is. So John wants us to understand a little bit more about this foundation of God's love in our lives. Notice in verses 7 and 8 here, "Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. So he ties throughout this passage here love for God and love for others. God revealed his love to us in that he is a God of love. And John wanted each of these readers that he was writing to back then that the true mark of a believer is this agape love, the kind of love that God showed towards us. It's a sacrificial love. It's a self-denying, giving love of God. In fact, in John 3:16, we love that verse, for God so loved, and that is to a Christ-rejecting and simple world. He loved us, even while we were yet sinners, Romans says, that he gave, because love is always giving, his only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. You see, in this love, God provided a sacrifice for our sins. So God is love, meaning it's a part of his intrinsic part of who he is, an essential part of his nature. And God cannot think or feel or act in any way but in love. This is the foundation of our lives. And the devil wants us to doubt that and question that in our lives. No matter what our circumstances might be, we need to rest our lives solidly on this foundation that God loves us. He loves you. He loves me. Now, people sometimes say, well, why could a loving God allow these things to happen in the world? Why would God, a loving God, send people to hell? Well, he doesn't send anybody to hell. People choose. People choose. And see, that's about love. We want love that is reciprocated in kind, a self-giving love. When we love our spouses and our kids, it's not that we want something in return. We just give it because we want to. And that something better when we receive it back out of a heart of love rather than a heart of obligation. Well, I think God feels that way about us too. He wants us to love him not out of obligation, but out of a heart of love. And that's why he doesn't do this. It's only about when people reject Jesus as their Savior. It is a choice. And God is not going to force anyone to do anything different than what they choose to do. And if we want to go to heaven, we don't have to. If we want to, we know the way. If we don't want to, if people joke, I join my friends. No, you're not going to be joining friends. I hate to tell you that. It's not what Scripture teaches. It's a lonely, dark place. We have a choice. God is love, and he wants us to exercise that free will so that we can spend eternity with him. Now, see, he loves us, but he also hates sin and iniquity. It's popular to say God is love, and he loves everybody in the same way. But God loves us, including sinners. And yet God continues to show his love towards us, even though we sin. But he hates the sin, not the sinner. He hates unrighteousness and wants us to be forgiven and have a relationship with him. God's love is a God that's acting benevolently toward all of us, providing for our needs. He sent his son to die on the cross for us so that our sins could be forgiven and we could be reconciled to God in a love relationship. See, that's what Christianity is. It's about a love relationship with our Heavenly Father and his son, Jesus Christ. God loves us and we respond by loving him in return. So whenever we have this life within us, we can find it's present and it can be found within us. And according to what John's saying here, if it's not found in us, then maybe we aren't the children of God that we think we are. It does us no good to claim to have something like the love of God in us and yet not display it in our lives. If we cannot treat people lovingly and see through the irritating qualities that offend some of us, their need for God's love is then maybe we're not the child of God that we think we are. But if our reaction to those who offend us with opposition and antagonism, then we should claim that we belong to God, then God's love's going to be there. It's right there for us. If the life of God is present in us, then the love of God is there too. Can't have one without the other. And that's what John's saying here. That love of God is a part of his character and therefore passed on to us as his children. You know, that's kind of what he was, you know, what we think about with kids and so on. We pass on that legacy, right, of who we are. And, you know, sometimes people see, oh, I see that quality of the parent in the child. Is that true of us and our Heavenly Father? He's our Heavenly Father. He's our Savior. And He calls us to be like Him. And He says, my love is there for you. I'm so glad the choir sang What Wondrous Love Is This. It's a beautiful old hymn that expresses those truths of who God is. But He says also here in the next few verses, verses 9 to 11, that God's love is expressed. This is how God's love is shown among us. He sent His one and only Son into the world that we might live through Him. This is love, not that we love God, but that He loved us and sent His Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, since God so loved us, we ought also to love one another. See, God demonstrated or proved or manifested His love towards us. And we have the love of God as far as our nature is concerned. We have His love of God, He says, towards us, since it was sent to us by His Son when He died on the cross for our sins. When we have the love of God then in us, we have the love of God flowing through us. So when we ask ourselves, is there any proof of concrete evidence that God is love? The answer is yes. And that is that God sent His Son to die on the cross for you and for me. There it is, tangible. You can touch it. It's real. It's not ethereal or wishful thinking. It's right there, right before us. He sent His one and only Son. That's the demonstration of His love. Notice that God did this. So God, who is love and the source of love, was motivated by His love to provide for our needs. So He sent His one and only Son. And it's interesting that term, only begotten or only Son, means unique. Isn't that a great way of expressing it? Jesus is God's unique Son. We are adopted children into the family of God. Jesus was the only begotten, the only unique Son of God. And it speaks of Jesus' deity. It, you know, when we say that Jesus is unique, it means He's one of a kind. That worship song we've been singing, right? There's no one like our God. No. He's one of a kind. He's a unique person of the Godhead. There is no equal to Him. The Father took the initiative of Jesus and sent Him. And it means that Jesus preexisted before He came to earth because He was sent, right? So He's a second person of the Godhead. We talk about that. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, all God, the triune God. And this verse tells us that we need to take a look at that then and say, all right, God sent His Son to us to help us understand His great love for us, to show that He cares for us and encourages us. There's an old saying that the Latins used to say, says, where there is love, tender affection, there God is. Where there is love and tender affection, there God is. That should be reflective in our lives, shouldn't it? It should be a part of who we are. And that's exactly what John is getting at right here. When we see real love at work, we can really see and believe that God, the Spirit, is at work at will. John is saying that only Christians can properly imitate it and show and reflect this love which flows from God Himself. Because why? Because He gave us His nature at salvation. And His nature is what? Love. And so therefore, we have that nature within us. We don't have to well it up. We don't have to try to create something in us to love one another. We can give that love to God the way that He wants us to. And not only did He send His only Son, His unique Son, but He sent Him to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Now, it's a little theological, but it's important that we understand this. It's a reference to the sacrificial death of Jesus on the cross. The word atoning sacrifice means that when Jesus died on the cross, He not only died to take away our sins, but He also came to satisfy God's justice. See, that's the balance there. God's love, God's just. You can't have either or, it's both and. And so He did that when He died on the cross. The Father's righteous law had been violated. He said, don't sin. We sinned. And the penalty for sin is death, according to what Romans 6:23, the wages of sin is death. But the good news, gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. See, and there's the love that comes in despite the justice that God demanded. So when Jesus died on the cross, he died to satisfy the holiness of our great God. Only Jesus could do this. When Jesus died, he said what? It's finished, paid in full. So we can be reconciled back to God, so we can have a relationship with God. And that's so important. We have been justified, which means that we've been declared righteous by God. And so we are adopted then into his family as children of God and have that relationship with him. Wow. What a great God we have. Amen. There is no one like our God. And we need to keep reminding ourselves of this. And that's, I believe, what John is really wants us to take away from this passage. You know, when we look at the cross, we see all those moral attributes of God manifested. We see the love of God because he gave his life. We see the holiness of God because he died to pay for our sins, because the law is righteous and had to be paid for. We see the justice of God taken care of by Jesus' death, and it sets us free. The grace of God there on the cross gives us his righteousness, which is undeserved and unmerited, but still it's credited to our account in our lives, and we're justified before a holy God. So I've always said, it's the best transaction in the world. God takes our sin, we get his righteousness. Wow, no better deal on earth. No better deal. That's what John's talking about here. The love of God promotes that. The love of God helps us to see that in our hearts and our lives. J.I. Packer, great pastor, wrote a book called Knowing God. It's on one of the many books on my shelf there in my office. He said this, God's love is an exercise of his goodness towards sinners. An exercise of his goodness towards sinners. Think about that. He gave his son to be their savior, to bring them to know and enjoy him in a covenant relationship. See, he sent us so that we could have a relationship with him. It's, again, that recreation of what happened back in the garden. He created Adam and Eve for fellowship. Sin separated them from that. How do we get that back? By Jesus dying on the cross for our sins, being raised from the dead in heaven forever, and we will worship him at his feet. You see, Jesus came out of love as well to die in our place. Another pastor, John Stott, wrote, no greater gift of God is conceivable because no greater gift was possible. No greater gift was possible than God's own son, his only unique son. He also wrote, John Stott wrote this, this is the most comprehensive and sublime of all the biblical affirmations of God's being. It means that at the root of all God does is love. Now it's interesting, right? 1 Corinthians 13, faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is what? Love. Yeah. There's a lot of things that we are to have in our hearts and lives, but love needs to permeate that. It shows us that is the way that God wants us to reflect his love to others. Now, this means that at the root of all God does is a matter of love. Now, no matter how difficult it may be, the fountain from which all God's activity stems is a self-giving love. Even his judgments, his condemnations come from a heart of love. Judgment is not separate from love. Think about that. If one could convince us that a holy, loving God cannot judge an evil being, then that person will also have to be convinced that God cannot love that person. So you can't have one without the other. It's two sides of the coin. And we see this even in humans, especially in mothers. Attack a child, the mother present, and see how that mother law flares out in immediate opposition, resentment, and antagonism to anyone who threatens the love of their life. See, God's love is similar to that. See, he lashes out at those who do not follow him. He does care about us, and he does love us, and he's going to love us because he's not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance, right? That's his heart. Yet, love is not always easy to live with because of that very quality, yet is the most attractive and wonderful thing in the world because of its warmth and embracing inclusiveness that takes in all kinds and all conditions without looking to the merit of any one particular person. God sent his love towards us in his son, and that brings us assurance. We have the assurance of the fact that God loves us and of God's love to us by sending his son, of God's love in sending his spirit, and in God's love through us so that Christ could live out his life in our hearts and lives. See, we are to be the outreach of God to the world around us. And the way that we can do this, he explains this in the last part. God's love is in us, verses 12 to 15. Notice these verses. No one ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us and his love is made complete in us. This is how we know that we live in him and he in us. He has given us his spirit. And we have seen and testified that the Father has sent his Son to be the Savior of the world. If anyone acknowledges that Jesus is the Son of God, God lives in them and they in God. So he's saying it's a two-way street here. God's love is in us, and because of that, we need to demonstrate that to others. And it not only needs to be loved and proclaimed, but it has a purpose. God's love has a purpose. There's three purposes. Number one is to teach us to love one another. Why is that so hard? Even among believers. I've seen some ugly things in churches through the years. Not loving. Not loving at all. It's one of the things I love about this church. You love each other. And I want to encourage you to keep doing it. Keep on doing it. And even more. Because that's what God wants us to do with that love. Not only does God want us to communicate his holiness, which again is communicable. In other words, he said, be holy as I am holy. God doesn't expect anything from you that he does not give you the power to do. So if he says, be holy, we can be holy. If he says, love others, we can love others. See, he gives us that ability. If we are children of God and God is love, then we need to love one another. People can't see God because God is a spirit. But if we are like God, are self-giving to one another, and it's a visible then manifestation of the love of God that is in each of us. Jesus was the greatest manifestation of the love of God in Scripture, and we see that right through the Gospels. John was there in the upper room when Jesus said, love one another, for the world will know that you are my disciples. How? By the way you love one another. See, the two most powerful tools for extension of the gospel are the word of God and the love that Christians need to have for each other. We are to love because people need it. Not that we're all lovable. We're just so easy to love. It doesn't always happen. That's why I believe in Romans. I just told this somebody, I tell it to a lot of people. Romans 12 says, as much as lies within you, live with peace with all people. I think God knew and Paul knew when he wrote that to the Romans that we're not always going to get along. But we are always to love one another. Okay? That's the difference right there. And we need to show that love towards each other. And that's the expression of God's love in our lives today. And that's what he's saying here. True love is an interest and concern for another person. That is the love that takes notice of what the person is like or does and how they dress or anything like that about their background. It doesn't see that. Here is another person, another one like you and me, with all the longings, heartaches, searching, problems, aspirations, and hopes. They have the same frustrations as you and me. We need to love them. We need to love them. See, unless we have the life of God, we cannot love another person. Unless we have God's nature with us, we're not going to be able to do that. But when we have the life of God in our salvation, We can love like this, and we ought to do so, he says here. He says, you should do this. This is reflective of who we are. God is in us, and so his love comes through us. He is waiting for our willingness to love. Again, he doesn't force us to do anything. He's willing for us to do that. So, as he says here, so God so loved us, we ought also to love one another. And with an unjudging characteristic, not based upon qualities or preferences of another person, but just because that person is another person created in the image of God. See, we're all created in the image of God, and I've mentioned this before. Sin mars that image, and we don't see that. But when we get saved, that film is gone. And we really, people get to see the real image of God in us as believers. John says, if we love one another, God abides in us, and his love is perfected in us. It reaches its completion in us. That is where people see God's love, and it's the only place it can be seen. The fact that the indwelling God becomes visible when we manifest our love towards one another, that kind of love is what John is talking about. We're nice to only our friends and to those who are nice to us. No one has any idea that God's around. Jesus said that. You like your friends, so what? Love your enemies. And then you show the love of God. But when we start being nice to those who are nasty to us, start turning good for evil, being patient and tender, thoughtful and considerate about those who are stubborn, obstinate, and selfish, say difficult things to us, then people get the sense that God is in that situation. That within us becomes visible to another person. And many of us today are not acquainted with the Gospels, according to Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, but every person is going to be reading the Gospel according to you and me. What do we see? What do they see in us? To allow his life, his love, to be manifested in our lives. There's the old hymn, channels only, blessed Savior. That whole aspect of let me be a channel of your love towards others. Let us allow that then to be shown deliberately in our kindness and our thoughtfulness and consideration towards others. What John says here then, that God is love. And this love pouring out from this amazing being, who he is, Jesus Christ our Lord, being whose concern for vast millions on earth is individualized and wrapped up in a beautiful, amazing love for each of us. It's perfected in you and me. Only when it becomes visible then to other people will they know that we are Christ's disciples. This love of God is his character. It is who he is. And it was expressed to us by his sending his only unique Son of God to die on the cross for our sins. And because of this demonstration of his love, we are to love each other. It's no debate. This is not open for debate. God's word says do it. We need to do it. Again, you've heard me say this. We are the only Jesus some people will ever see. How are we doing? So let us love one another and be known as people who love each other. Father, we thank you for your presence here today. Thank you for your great love for us. You're a great God, worthy of all praise. Father, we thank you, we bless you and praise you, because you are a great, magnificent God. No one like you. We worship you, Almighty God. There is none like you. So help us, Father, to be faithful to your calling on us, that we would show the love of God to everyone, not just to who we think deserve it, but to all, so that they will know God loves them. Thank you for these truths in Jesus' name. Amen. Stand together and sing this wonderful song of prayer. They will know we are Christians by our love.
We are one in the Spirit, we are one in the Lord. We are one in the Spirit, we are one in the And we pray they that all unity may one day be restored, and they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. Then we'll know we are Christians by our love. We will work with each other. Side by side, we will work with each other. We will work side by side, and we'll guard each one's dignity and save each one's pride. And they'll know we are Christians by our love, by our love. And they'll
May that be your prayer today. Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God the Father and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. God bless you. Have a great week.